I had a question on the two houses of Israel, or some people say two states. So when we say, when we talk about the two houses of Israel, so what we're talking about, the prodigal son, where the Gentiles, so we are the youngest son, like the Gentiles who've gone out, you know, we spent the money, we did everything wrong, we knew, we didn't know about the Torah, and later on we come to know the Torah. And then it says the elder one is like the Judah, the Jews who kept the Torah and those who preserved it. But eventually when we are, you know, coming together, it looks like they don't like it, right? So in a way, is this kind of replacing, you know, we are replacing the Jews? Or do I say that, you know, I mean, it's still a one body, right? I mean, there is only one physical Israel. So the people, those who have not accepted Mashiach, you know, the people who was in Israel or somewhere else, they still don't know about Christ, right? They don't know about Mashiach. They don't know that he kept the Torah. I mean, they are also still, you know, the body of Messiah, right?
I want to make it simplified for Javier and for everyone else that's listening. This is why I read the scriptures and I don't get caught up in these different theories and these names of the one house and two house movement and all this. Actually, if you want to go into the names, I think they're backwards. I think that the theology of the two house movement is really a one house movement, a one house theology. And the theology of the one house is really a two house. So I think that's backwards, but don't get caught up or confused with all that. Just read the scriptures for what they are for themselves. And just look at the people when the children of Israel came out of Egypt, who came out with them? A whole bunch of Egyptians that weren't born of the tribe of Jacob. They weren't Judah, and they weren't even Israel or part of Israel, but they became the part of the commonwealth of Israel. And they now were responsible to keep the Torah and to do everything else that the Israelites or that Israel was doing. And basically what it comes down to, and to simplify this for you on a very simple level, is it doesn't matter where you came from. It matters where you're going. And you have that choice. Now, when you look at it from a scriptural context, anytime it addresses Israel as to do something, you have to understand the word Gentile doesn't mean not Jewish. The word Gentile means heathen or the nations. You cannot be a believing Gentile. That's an oxymoron. Once you become a believer, you are no longer a Gentile. You are now Israel. You are part of the commonwealth of Israel. If you want to call that our house or whatever you want to call it, a tree or branch, call it what you want. But you are now part of that. And you are responsible to keep the guidelines and instructions, or to simplify it even more, the will of our Father. And the great thing is, every single blessing that's promised to Israel, you can now receive based on your obedience. Every single one of us already has the greatest gift ever given to man of Yeshua dying for us. We have that great opportunity, and that's what it is. It's an opportunity to take hold of that and live according to his will. What we do with that opportunity is our own choice. But do not get confused or caught up in these names and these new teachings that come along. When you read the scriptures straight for what it is, you're not going to start questioning if you haven't already heard or got caught up into it. Any of these things that people are talking about calendars, about names, about all this other stuff, the scriptures speak for itself, and the scriptures are not difficult to understand. And each time you read the scriptures, more and more things are going to be revealed to you, more you're going to see there, and you are going to change your mind about certain things. The problem isn't the scriptures that are confusing. The problem is there's so many different peoples of man's ideas that get in the way. When it comes to this issue, it's very simple. It's not about where you came from. It's about where you're going. Do you want to receive the full benefit that comes along with Yeshua dying for us? If so, learn the will of our Father and follow it. That's what it comes down to. But understand, when it comes to names, you cannot be a believing Gentile. You're either Israel or you're not. And you have that choice. And there's a narrow path out there. And we have that choice which road we want to be on. But at the end of that narrow path is a narrow gate. That narrow path is Torah, and that narrow gate is Yeshua. So we have that opportunity if we decide to take it. And all these people that get caught up in the names or the titles of these different theories, it's confusing people more than anything else. I don't see it helping people, especially new people coming into this movement and taking sides and everything else. I'm on Yahweh's side, and his side says every single person has an opportunity for these blessings, and I want my will, everyone to follow it. And me being a father, and I have children, and I have instructions for my children, it's for their safety and for their benefit. And whether I adopt children or whether I get a blended family or whatever, every single one of them can still have the same benefits and blessings if they follow the same instructions. There's no different set of instructions for a different set of people. It's all one and the same. And it's a wonderful thing. It's a wonderful gift. And the Bible in general is a clear message. The only way is to follow the will of the Father. Yeshua was the living Torah who set that example for us. And he also set that example of the greatest love that we can ever do, is literally giving our bodies up and dying so somebody else can seek the benefit of that. So praise Yahweh. So please, Javier, and anyone else that's new to the scriptures, and you hear this stuff about the one house and the two house and all these other distractions, just read your scriptures and you'll see it for yourself right there. But if you want to question this, if you want, look who came out of Egypt. It wasn't just the Jewish people, and all throughout the scriptures, even in the bloodline of Yeshua, you had people that weren't necessarily from Judah. So there you go. So that's my 2.5 cents on that one. So hopefully that'll simplify it up for you and not clarify it up
for you. Clarify it up for you.
Right.
Okay, Javier, are you still there?
Yeah, I'm still there. So I understand what you're saying, but you know, one question is, you know, what about the Jews who are in Israel or anywhere, those who are keeping the Torah and they do not know about the Mashiach?
Okay. Well, when you say what about them?
So those who are keeping the Torah. So I mean, they're also Israel, right? In a way, although they have not known the Messiah. Who's going to talk?
The scriptures are very clear when they give examples of people, no matter how they were living. If they don't accept Messiah, you know what's going to happen to them, and basically. If you're asking, you know, who is Israel or what truly is Israel, every single person has an opportunity to know who Messiah was. This wasn't a fiction thing that happened. This was a real life act that happened. So if you claim that Yeshua is not Messiah, you're literally rejecting him. And the scriptures are clear on that. It's very clear. So I don't care how much Torah a person is keeping or how much Bible they're following. If they're going to reject what Yeshua did for us, they're not accepting Yeshua. And they're going to be, remember, salvation doesn't come from our works. Salvation comes from faith in Him. If we have that faith in Him, and we do the works. Right. It's a whole different story. We're just doing the works. And yes, we can be safe by doing the works. Certainly, living the lifestyle of Torah can help us. Whether somebody believes in Yeshua or not, living a lifestyle of Torah can only benefit us. However, it's not the completion without Yeshua.